Penguin presents The Search by Howard Linskey, read by Kieran Bew. To Alison and Erin. Prologue. My Story by Adrian Wicklow. I screamed from day one. I was born screaming, or so my dear mother told me. I screamed from the moment they dragged me into this ridiculous world. This one has plenty to say for himself, the midwife told her, and she was right about that. But no one was listening. Nobody paid me any attention, not for years. Then I started killing, and it all changed. All of a sudden, people cared. I killed again and again. They were desperate to find me then. Some of them became obsessed with me. It felt so good to know I was in everybody's thoughts. You see, everything changed when I started taking their children. They noticed me then. Chapter 1. 1976. I dare you to do it, she told him. I double dare you. So it was a double dare, and he couldn't just ignore it. Why should I? Because I double dare you, she repeated. And there was no arguing with that. It was reason enough for a 10-year-old boy to do as he was asked. The fact she was a girl, and he didn't want to look like a coward in front of her, clinched it. If he didn't do this dare, she'd tell all the other girls and they'd flap their elbows like chickens and make clucking noises when he walked by. He couldn't bear the thought of that. But it was a very long way down. Maybe she would tell the girls if he did do it, and then he'd be a bloody hero. That gave him courage. And he took a step closer to the edge, but only a step. He was still a little way back from the perimeter fence, but he could see the great expanse of the old limestone quarry ahead of him. Most of the basin of the huge quarry was flooded, and nature had reclaimed it. Vegetation grew where once bare rock had been, while thick bushes thrived all around the floodwater, from the bottom of the slopes until they hugged the steep sides of the quarry, which were covered in moss. Even trees grew out of the ledges here, before stretching upwards as if trying to climb the cliffs of the quarry so they could haul themselves out and make a break for freedom. The limestone had been hewn out years ago for building projects, and all that remained was a huge crater. Most of the stone became part of the new houses that widened the village of Maiden Hill on all sides during the boom years of the 60s. These two up, two downs ringed the village like the circled wagons in a western. The enormous hole that remained seemed to stretch for miles and miles, but he could still see the other end. It wasn't how wide the crater was that was troubling him, it was how deep it looked. Every kid in the village was frightened of the quarry. They had all heard tales of children who had disappeared out here, swallowed up by the dark water at one end of the crater, or dashed to pieces on the rocks at the other. Everyone knew that ghosts lived out here, and bogeymen. And there was a grey lady, too, who haunted the place after dark and could scare people to death with just one look. You were all right as long as you went in a group or with a friend. But if you came out here on your own, those evil spirits would rush out at you and push you over the edge of the quarry, just so they could watch you fall and listen while you screamed. Every kid knew that. The adults didn't believe it, though. His mum had told him it was all nonsense. Don't you think I'd have read about it in the paper? She asked him, while she was baking in the kitchen. If a kid had gone over the edge of that quarry, don't you reckon we'd have heard about it if someone was missing a child? And she laughed at his fears and offered him her wooden spoon to lick the cake mix from. Adults didn't understand these things. They had forgotten what it was like to be a child, to believe in something because you just know it deep down to be true. They had to be told things by the TV or newspapers, but they were just stories as well. So how did they know they weren't made up? He knew the stories were real, but he couldn't understand why the girl wasn't scared, and this meant he couldn't be frightened either. He wasn't allowed to be more scared than a girl. That was another rule. He hesitated now and looked at the gap in the wire. I'll go through the fence as well, she assured him. Just to watch you, I'm not doing it. But you can do it. I bet you can. He took his time thinking about it, then gingerly edged further forward until he was able to stretch out his leg and push it through a gap in the fence. He wondered who had pulled at this first, and how long it had taken them to worry away at it until they were able to bend the wire up and apart, forcing a hole in the fence that had been placed here to keep everyone away from the sheer drop that lay beyond it. He wondered how many other kids had gone through it, as he was about to. He had to hold on to the wire and lower himself virtually to the ground, so he was almost on his back, then slide his feet through the gap first, his coat catching on the ragged wire until he managed to wriggle free. Then he was through the gap, and he stood up on the other side. A giddy, dizzying feeling sweeping over him, part excitement, part fear. "See," she said from behind the fence, "you did it, and there's plenty of room." And there was. Kind of. He was standing on a plateau that jutted out into the bowl of the quarry's giant crater, but there was nothing now to protect him from a long fall onto sharp rocks. The fence had been placed around the quarry in a large, uneven circle. Most of the time, it went right to the edge, and there was nothing beyond the fence but a sheer drop. The crater wasn't a perfect circle, though, so here and there, slabs of land became imprisoned beyond the fence and jutted out into the quarry like jetties on a lake. The bit he was standing on was easily large enough for her to join him, and she wriggled through. On one side, tall, thick bushes created a natural barrier at the edge. The other side of the plateau was unprotected. He felt sick just standing there now. He knew if he were to close his eyes and take 3 steps, he would fall over the edge, then be dead and gone forever.
"You've done it!"
"Almost," she said, but that wasn't true. The really hard part, the bit she had double-dared him to do, still remained. She wanted him to hold onto the wire fence from the inside and leave the relative safety of the rocky outcrop to make his way along the edge of the quarry, which had only a small, rutted bit of grassy land against it to keep him safe. He would have to plant his feet on a ledge that wasn't much wider than his shoes, while holding on for his life with splayed fingers that clutched the octagonal gaps in the wire as he went hand over hand. He leaned forward again and looked at the ground far below.
"I don't know," he said, trying to sound calm. "What if I fall?"
"You won't fall. Freddie Andrews didn't fall."
"Yeah, but he's 13, he reminded her, "and his dad's in prison."
This meant Freddie had nothing to lose because his life was already horrible, and it wasn't ever going to get any better. Not never. Freddie had scrambled around that edge from the inside like he didn't care if he fell or not. He'd reached the other gap in the wire, which had to be at least 20 steps along the ledge, before you even knew it. Then he'd climb out to cheers that must have been the highlight of his sad young life.
"Nah," he said. "I could do it."
He wanted her to know he was capable of the act.
"I just don't want to."
"Go on,"
she urged him. She smiled then, and the smile seemed to come from deep within, and something lit up inside him. That smile made him want to do anything she asked. Anything. There was a fire in her eyes when she said, "I triple dare you."
Chapter 2. 1996.
"So I suppose I was the last one to see her alive," Billy told the awestruck girl in the pub. "Well, not the last, obviously." And he gave her the grim half-smile he always used at this point.
"Oh my God," she said, "that's terrible." He was already wondering if he'd overcooked it, or whether the line had grown stale from repetition over the years. It hadn't quite tripped off his tongue this time. He felt like an old club comedian who had told the same joke once too often. And he was drunk. Perhaps too drunk. None of this stopped her from taking his hand in hers and giving it a supportive squeeze, so maybe there was some hope. The barren run had to end sometime, right?
"It's just so sad and awful."
She was empathizing now, her eyes wide and tears beginning to form in them.
"I don't know how you've coped with this for so long."
She shook her head solemnly, and he wondered if she would lean in for the hug, or if perhaps he should risk it. But he hesitated, mindful of the age gap between them. Was it really 11 years?
Apparently so. He was 30, and this student was just 19. It had been so much easier when he was the same age as them. Teenagers were always so emotional with one another. And everything.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.